Why don't you just basically tell us about some of the books you've written and also some of the documentation of CIA drug running that you've come across?
Well, I came to the table with a background in Air Force intelligence, 8 years during the Vietnam War, worked with the CIA and Air America, and so I know how the intelligence community functions, how it's organized. And after my discharge from the Air Force, I worked directly with the FBI's counterintelligence division for 3 years, and then that led me into contract work with the CIA in an obscure place called Mena, Arkansas, back when Bill Clinton was governor and back when George Bush was the president. And I personally witnessed a complicity between these two men, Bush and Clinton, in terms of transporting cocaine into the U.S. For the purpose of sale to generate money to fight a war. And that war at the time was the conflict in Central America involving the Sandinistas in Nicaragua. In 1970, it's well documented that the organization that was flying the classified material for Air America, codenamed Scatback, was busted. This whole fleet of airplanes and pilots was busted for hauling heroin disguised as classified material in an attempt to smuggle that back to Hawaii. And if you get to Hawaii, then it's a free ride back to the United States, because that's part of the United States. There's now, no customs to clear.
That is documented there, but back to the absolute documentation, tell us how you were involved in Mena with then Governor Clinton of Arkansas and President Bush, who had also been director of the CIA earlier in the 70s.
I met Oliver North in 1982. He was with the National Security Council. He's the man who recruited me as a civilian to get involved in the Contra resupply operation. He told me that this was taking place in Mena, Arkansas, that George Bush was overseeing the entire project in order to insulate the executive branch from the scheme, because certainly there were constitutional considerations there. I went to Mena, I met a man named Barry Seal, who I was told was the CIA contractor who had the contract to resupply the Contras. Sure, in fact, I found a large base there under construction. I was hired initially to be a flight instructor. I'm a certified flight instructor. My last tour of duty in Southeast Asia was to assist the Cambodians and equip them to fight a covert war. And here we were doing basically the same kind of training. This time we were equipping Nicaraguans to fight communism in Central America.
And did you ever actually see the cocaine, or you just were at the base and knew that it was being flown in?
No, after walking around with blinders on for 2 years, it became to the point I could no longer deny what was going on. And as I document and discuss in my book, Compromised, it's a book I wrote about this subject, Compromise Clinton, Bush, and the CIA. In 1987, I came face to face with a C-130 full of cocaine, just literally tons of it stored in ammunition boxes on a flight that was returning. And from that point on, I couldn't deny it. And I asked for a full-scale investigation and went directly to Oliver North, I might point out, to request for that to occur. And the investigation obviously didn't happen. I was labeled a security risk and a threat to the operation, which clearly showed to me that this was being sponsored and sanctioned by the U.S. government.
So they were flying guns out and coke in?
Yeah.
Heroin also?
I have no knowledge of that. It was cocaine.
Where are we going now today? Would you say that the majority of... How big a percentile of the narcotics coming into this nation are controlled by the National Security Agency or the CIA?
I have no way of knowing, but I use logic on these kinds of scenarios. If you are to believe the Pentagon, and I do, we have a security net over this country, downlooking satellites and radar that is designed to stop as small of an incoming target as a surface, as an air-to-ground missile launched from a Soviet MiG out of Cuba. Now, if that's the case, and you can do that, and I believe we can do that, that's been proven time and time again we can, you have to ask yourself, how are all these drugs getting into this country?
So what are the drug busts that we see? Are those cowboys or people that were not inside who are not licensed drug runners for the CIA being busted?
Oh, the independent, the entrepreneurs, the little guys, the guys with a Cessna that gets caught with a duffel bag full and goes to prison for life. The juxtaposition of that is a C-123 with 5 tons coming in unabated.
How do we stop this? Just education?
No. We, the American people, first of all, say we don't want a war on drugs. I'm for total legalization of drugs.
Well, some people will be shocked by that, but back in the 1920s during Prohibition, alcohol abuse skyrocketed. It created giant armed gangs. If you make something illegal and risque, a giant black market rises.
Well, black market is what the problem is. The profits are there. Take the profit out.
And then it loses the flair and it loses the money.
Not only does it lose that, anybody else still in the trade certainly surfaces as a cold sore real abruptly. The banks that launder the money would surface and probably go bankrupt. It'd be interesting as an experiment, I've always said, to let's say we're not going to do this permanently, but for 3 months, for 90 days, we're going to have a test, and we're going to legalize cocaine for 90 days, and just see the reaction of corporations, companies, big businesses that are in the drug business, and banks that launder the proceeds, and watch them surface, because they would go into withdrawal. Real abruptly.
Well, Mr. Reed, just two more short questions, and I appreciate your time with us here today. The general public has a gut-level feeling that the information you're discussing is true. Even Esquire did a large article 2 months ago about it in their September issue, documenting it, DEA people, carte blanche admitting it. And we've seen articles in early 97 about the Federal Reserve Bank of Dallas and San Antonio being caught with $3 billion of drug money. This goes to the highest levels. Truthfully, it's good to say we should decriminalize drugs. But at the same point, isn't the war on drugs also creating the police state that they like?
That's my greatest concern. I don't say let's legalize drugs because I want to see you use drugs or anybody else. We have not had a war on drugs. We've had a war on our Bill of Rights, under the guise of the war on drugs. I never thought I'd ever live to see the day in this country that I fought for to have roadblocks, arbitrary roadblocks. Now, passengers and vehicles have no rights, as you know, that the passenger has an obligation to show his or her identification.
Asset forfeiture seizure.
The test case before the Supreme Court as we speak is, are the passengers' belongings in a vehicle subject to involuntary search, and I believe the Supreme Court will go along and say they police have the right to stop and search you and me or anybody else in a vehicle. The Fourth Amendment is worthless. It's been trampled on. It's useless.
And this is reminiscent of Nazi Germany.
Absolutely. So if we want to return to a nation of greatness, we're forced to legalize drugs just simply to preserve our civil liberties guaranteed us under the Bill of Rights.
And then if some idiot wants to OD, that's their problem. Don't take my civil liberties.
To me, that person who OD'd is a lot less threat than a group of SWAT team officers kicking down a door inadvertently and shooting the wrong guy.
And saying it's because of drugs.
Absolutely.
That's their umbrella. Mr. Reed, thank you very much for talking to us.
Thank you.